Everybody hates repairing iPads. They've been a terrible repair experience ever since they've existed, earning twos and threes on our repairability scale. But is the new iPad Pro about to come change all of that? A CT scan of the new iPad Pro M5 shows why iPads and tablets in general are so hard to repair. At just 5.1 millimeters thickness, it's thinner than an iPhone Air, which means the screen is mounted flush against the internals. And the only way in is through that big, beautiful, and expensive tandem OLED screen. As you've probably guessed by now, once your battery starts to wear out somewhere around the 3-year mark, this huge, fragile screen needs to come off first. Good luck doing that without cracking the screen. Despite this glaring design flaw, Apple has taken some solid steps towards repairability on these iPads by providing manuals and parts. So let's start this teardown and take a peek under the hood of the 13-inch iPad Pro M5. Unlike most other devices, there are no external screws on the iPad. It's just glue, and there's really only one way of dealing with glue, and that's heat. Lots of it. The best chance I have of opening the device up without damage is using my iFixit anti-clamp. It takes out the guesswork of how much force is needed to pry up the screen. Once I have a gap, I can cut away some of the glue and wedge a pick under the screen. This is the riskiest part of this operation, cutting the glue all around the edge of the screen. As I said before, the margins on these tablets are extremely tight because everything is packed in so closely together. The screen removal process is utterly unforgiving to the smallest mistakes, and it only takes one to turn this marvel of engineering into a 13-inch pile of e-waste. With the screen released, I can slightly rotate it to reveal a microphone flex. This needs to be disconnected before I can fold the screen back and expose the shielded section of the logic board where the screen's four press connectors live. With the shield off, I can pop the press connectors one by one and remove the screen. And now I can finally access the battery press connector, cutting power to the device and making it safe to work on. The battery is the component most likely to fail, so I want to remove that first. To prepare for that, I'll need to pop a microphone press connector, disconnect the battery interconnect, and peel back the mic flex cable. This clears a path for the battery to come out once it's released. Then it's onto the 10 pull tabs, securing the battery in place. Pull tabs are fine when they work, but these ones were a bit of a pain to get to because of how thin the battery is and how short the end of the pull tabs are. They did the job okay, and after a lot of squeaks and snaps, the battery does come out. The 38.99 watt-hour battery didn't get an upgrade this year as far as I know. It's the same capacity battery we found in the 13-inch iPad Pro M4. Here's something exciting that isn't new, but I just forgot about. The USB-C port is easily accessible and removable, meaning any port damage can be repaired without much hassle. Once you get past that screen, that is. What is new is Apple's expansion of the self-service repair program this year to include iPads, so you can now find guides for some key repairs on day one, and as with other releases, we expect to see spare parts to be made available soon. And that's really exciting. It's exactly the kind of thing we want to see from manufacturers. Now, it would be very easy to say, but the part selection is limited, which, make no mistake, it absolutely is limited, but it's definitely a start, and they're providing components that third-party manufacturers may struggle to supply. I've got my eyes on the logic board next. It looks to be the same removal process as the iPad Pro M4. A few screws and a couple of sections of cowling need to come away to reveal press connectors and coax cables, plus the occasional bit of tape to remove. Rumor has it that next year's logic board will trade the simple copper sheet for an actual vapor chamber, which means the iPad Pros are getting the same thermal upgrade we found in the iPhone 17 Pro and Pro Max. As I'm taking apart the rear camera assembly, I think it's worth mentioning that every single screw I've encountered so far has been a JIS type screw, and we have bits for those in our ProTech toolkit. Here's a fun fact for you, JIS and Phillips look very similar, but there are subtle differences. Our bits are engineered to work with JIS screws, but a standard Phillips driver will eventually strip these. If you want to learn more about the difference between JIS and Phillips, check out the link in the description. With the cowling removed, I can now access a few press connectors and nudge a flex cable aside to remove yet another cowl that's securing the ambient light sensor and flash. I'll go ahead and remove the 12 megapixel f1.8 rear camera and the LiDAR scanner underneath it. That's all I can do here for now, so let's move on to the front-facing camera assembly. The camera is a fairly accessible part too. Once the cowling is removed, there's a couple of press connectors and two Torx screws on either side of the assembly. Those are the only non-JIS screws I'm going to run into during this teardown. Once the front-facing camera assembly is out, I can also remove the daughter board, which is connected to the front and rear-facing cameras, and the charging circuitry for the Apple Pencil. By the way, the Apple Pencil is still as sealed and unrepairable as always, and it still contains a lithium battery which can't be replaced. If you want to see what that teardown looks like, check out our iPad Pro M4 video from last year. With the daughter board removed, I can now get at the MEMS microphone, the flash, and the ambient light sensor from before. One last thing, we heard rumors that these new iPads might get a second selfie camera for vertical video calls. If that ever happens, that camera would sit right here where this microphone is at the top of the device. No camera to see this year though. The new iPad Pro M5 is a bit of a repairability paradox. On one hand, it's one of the least repair-friendly devices in Apple's lineup, a repair that beginners and experienced DIYers dread or outright avoid. Yes, on the other hand, and despite the underwhelming repairability, Apple is making an effort to help people service these things. They've done this by releasing guides with parts expected to arrive soon, and even renting out the tools their own technicians use at Apple service centers. But the biggest concern, as with so many electronics that we assess for repairability on this channel, is the battery. It's the one component guaranteed to wear out, remains trapped behind layers of glue and glass, with no realistic path for a casual fixer to replace it without risking catastrophic damage. It's with the balance of repairability, progress, and challenges in mind that, for the first time ever, we're giving an iPad a halfway decent repair score of 5 out of 10 on our repairability scale. Let's be clear though, a 5 out of 10 isn't where any manufacturer should be aiming for in repairability. Until they rethink how to make the battery accessible, it's unlikely these iPads will ever be more than half repairable.